Thank you, Pastor Sandy. Let's continue to clap our hands unto the Lord and give Him praise today. Oh, let's love Him. Let's love Him. Let's give Him thanks. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Glory to God. Glory to God. My, my, I feel the Holy Ghost here right now. Somebody forgot to tell Heritage Christian Life Center that God can't move on Sunday morning. The devil tries to tell people that. He says, God can't move on Sunday morning. It's time to take a little Sunday morning nap. But how many know the devil's a liar today and God is able? God is able. God is able. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen. 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 Well, God is so good. And it's wonderful to be back here in South Haven. And we just are coming from a youth camp in Alabama where we had a great time in the Holy Ghost in Birmingham. And last night got to be in Little Rock and hear Brother Matt Tuttle preach there. And I'm just feeling like I'm got jet fuel in my tank. Amen. So it's great to be back in the house of God. We love everybody and we love the spirit that's here. And it's wonderful to be back with Brother and Sister Sandy and the South Haven family here. No place like home. Amen. Amen. Good to have my friend Brother Miles Young with me. He's one of my dearest friends, him and his family and his in-laws, extended family. Are very close with my wife, myself, my boys, and they walked through us through probably one of the darkest times of our life. And you get to know people and you get a feel for people, and I'm glad he could be with me this morning here in church. Praise God. But let's jump right into the Word of God, if that's okay. Amen. If you've got your Bible, go ahead and turn to Genesis chapter 1. I'm going to go to the beginning of things. Genesis chapter 1. And I'm going to start reading at verse 1. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. Says, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, everybody say, God said. God said, let there be light. And there was light. And I want to take a few moments and just share with you some of the things that God placed on my heart here in preparation for this service this morning. I want to preach to you about the power of the Word of God. The power of the Word of God. Look at the person next to you. Tell them there is power in God's holy Word. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated. Praise God. If it's all right, I'd like to just kind of feel my way through this because it's worth taking our time and examining closely the dynamics of the Word of God. And not just the Word of God, but I want to eventually get to the spoken Word of God. I read something this last week that was pretty interesting. It was a Hebrew commentary. And in there, they pointed out the fact that when the scripture says that God said, that Hebrew word for said, the actual Hebrew word's running from me right now, but that word is more, it's more full, more robust than the English understanding of the word said. When we say a thing, it's about communication. And it's certain that God is communicating when He speaks. And it's data delivery for us. We say a thing, we're communicating, we are somehow interacting with the world around us. And it's one of our primary ways of communication, speaking. But when Hebrews read that God said, they don't just get a sense that there is a communing and knowledge being imparted or data being imparted. But there is a sense in that word that Hebrews get that Americans and other cultures don't get. And that is, there is a creative component to when God said. How many know that God's word is different than our word? Amen. And it's that dynamic I want to try to tap into this morning, because I want to say there's power in the word of God. Amen. I'm thankful for a chance to preach the word of God. And I'm glad I'm in a church that loves the word of God. I've been preaching just long enough to identify the fact that churches that are based on fellowship can be nice, but that's not the best way to build a church. And churches that are built upon music, they can be entertaining, and there can be charisma, and there can be talent, and there can even be anointing if a person is praying, but if it's built on music and a music program and a choir and musicians, perhaps paid musicians that are very professional in what they do, as talented as it might be, it's still not the same as being built on the Word of God. Amen. I can remember preaching in a church one time where they were losing their grip on the apostolic message. And when they did, as they were, their young people were starting to look different, act different, talk different. They were embracing new ideologies. And what it was is they were being carried about with trends and with the waves of modern interaction. And as society goes, that's how fellowship and music-driven churches are. But when you are a word-based church, when you take somebody and you put inside of them a love for the Word of God, and all the fellowship that's good is a fringe benefit, but the primary focus is the Word of God. And the music is great, but you know what? I'll take a lesser music program if you'll just give me the Word of God. Amen. Because it's the Word of God that is going to last forever. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word. Not the music, not the fellowship, not the fringe dynamics, but my word shall never pass away. So it just makes sense. Build your church on the word. Build your marriage on the word. Build your morality on the word. Build your thinking patterns on the word. Build your children. Oh, thank you, Jesus. On the word. If you build it on the word, everything else will, it will coalesce around that. It will gather around that. So that word, it's a dynamic thing. It's a powerful thing. It's a creative thing. To the point to where The scripture says that Jesus is the Word. He doesn't just possess the Word, but He is the Word. This is interesting because this is different than you and I. We are not the Word. He is the Word. The Word is not a thing. The Word is a person. Amen. We have to get our American objectifying minds away from the idea that these are things. I preached about it last Sunday. Death is not a thing. Death is a person. It's an enemy that will be overcome at the end of time. Amen. Resurrection is not an event. It's a person because Jesus is the resurrection. And the Word is not something you sit blandly through on Sunday morning and clip your nails or balance your checkbook while the preacher's preaching the Word. Amen. But there's eternal business being conducted right now. Amen. There's heavenly places that we're looking into right now. And I don't want to yawn my way through the application of the Word because creative stuff. Thank you, Jesus. Creative stuff is happening right now. Delivering stuff is happening right now. The Bible says He sent His Word and His Word set them free. Praise God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him. Who? The Word. Without Him was not anything made that was made. That Word was made flesh, dwelt among us. We beheld His glory. That's Jesus Christ. It's the Word of God. So when Satan comes to him in the wilderness and tries to trip him up, he tries to trip him up with the Word. And don't you know the devil's good at twisting. Let's talk about that for a minute, because it's an interesting thing. He comes to Jesus and he says, turn these stones to bread. Jesus uses the Word. You know that. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. Amen. Life's not all about your next meal. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that in the days of Noah, they were eating and drinking, marrying, giving in marriage until the day came and they knew not. Oh, but if you've got the Word, and if you realize man shall not live by bread alone, but we're supposed to live by the Word of God. I'm not good without the Word. I'm not good without Jesus Christ active in my life. I need the Word. And if I'm going to have a Starbucks, I need to have the Word at the same time. Because I'm not just fueled by my next meal. I'm fueled by communion with God and His Word that gets down in my spirit. Amen. A day without the Word of God is a bad day. It's a bad day. So he says, it is written. And so the devil says, oh, you want to talk about the Scripture? Okay, I can talk about the Scripture. He says, why don't you throw yourself off of this place and let's see if thou be the Son of God. And because it is written that he will give his angels charge over thee, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. And I know a lot of people that get tripped up right there. They get tripped up by the fake application of the Word of God. They don't dig deep enough. They don't push far enough. They have a casual relationship with the Word of God. Oh, hallelujah. But I'm not here to casually interact with the Word of God, but I'm here to let it get down in my bones. Do you ever read where it says the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and joints and marrow. This thing will get down in your bones. It'll get down on the inward part of a man. It's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. I'm not here to tickle your ears. I'm here to preach the word of God. I'm here to pull somebody out of false doctrine and pull somebody out of modern society ideology and pull somebody out of depression. And it'll happen by the word of God. That's how it'll happen. So he uses the scripture to trip up Jesus. Jesus says, don't try it with me. That may work for your backslidden cousin that's only interested in justifying their ungodly lifestyle. That may work on the weekend warrior. That may work for the person who's only interested in doing what their parents did because they're afraid of what they might uncover if they read too much. But that doesn't work for me. I'm not one you can twist the word with because I'm not casually acquainted with the word. I am the word. And I know what I meant when I wrote it in the first place. Let me tell you, they can try to use scripture to justify homosexual behavior, and they can try to use it to justify anything they want to. But the writer of the word knew what he meant when he wrote the word. And that doesn't mean jump off a cliff to prove you're a son of God. It means thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. I'm the one who wrote it in the first place. I am the word. I am the living, breathing, delivering, saving word of God. You can't play mind games with me. I wrote it in the first place. Praise God. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost right now. You feel that? You feel that little... that little wave that just took off. That's because it's not just a static data system. But he said, my word, it is spirit and it is life. It's a living thing. And it's amazing to me that God chose men women to preach his word, to teach his word. I hear it all the time. I hear people say, I'm not going to go listen to a man. I'm just going to read it from the Bible myself. And they'll say stuff like, the Lord is my shepherd. I don't need no man telling me. Now, nobody in here says that, but I'm sure you know people who have said that. We're talking about them today. And I'm not going to go to that church because I'm not going to let any man tell me what to do. And what fascinates me about that is it's God that chose men to preach to men. Has it ever struck you as amazing that it could have been the angels who preached it, but God said no? I mean, wouldn't it have been easier for Cornelius to be praying and an angel show up and the angel look at him and say, Cornelius, repent, be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And, I mean, FedEx, expedited delivery to your door. No wait. No 3-day delivery. No overnight shipping. But direct express mail to your door. God could use angels, but he doesn't use angels. When he said, who will go for me? Oh man, I feel the Holy Ghost. Who will go for me? He could have used Michael. He could have used Gabriel. He could have used anybody to preach the message of salvation. Now, he'll use them to tell Mary that you're going to have a baby. And he'll use it to tell Manoah and his wife that Samson's going to be born. And he'll use it to encourage Zechariah that John the Baptist is coming. But he's not going to get involved in the business of redemption. Because the Bible says, because by man came death, by man came salvation from death. We got ourselves in, and we're going to get ourselves out by the power of God. Who will go for me? Who will preach my word? And a boy named Isaiah says, I will go. Send me, Lord. And he goes, and the Bible says he sends an angel. And the angel takes a pair of tongs and he grabs a coal. Notice the angel doesn't touch the business of redemption himself, because this is not an angelic problem. This is a human problem. And the angels can't touch this thing. The Bible says they desire to look into it, but they're not able to look into it. This is a human predicament. He's not going to use angels. I feel the weight of it every morning when I wake up. When I wake up, I have to find a place to pray, because God has commissioned me to preach. That's not an easy job, because I fight the same devils you fight. I wrestle with the same garbage you wrestle with. I feel the same pressure you feel. I'm in this same old nasty world that you're in. I know people look at preachers in today's society like they're not the greatest of men, and all they want is money, and all they want is people's whatever. And I can feel that pressure. And there's a devil that tells me, stop preaching and just go out and get a regular job and just get along and just try to do the best you can. But I can't, because his word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. And I might feel unworthy, but he can put coals of fire on my lips and anoint me and purify me and say, I have purified you, now go. Amen. I know I'm the last one qualified, but I'm going to preach it anyway. I'm going to testify anyway. And you can laugh at me and you can mock me, but I'm going to speak his word, because there's power in his word. I know that they'll say that a prophet's not without honor but in his own country, but I'm going to preach it anyway. And so fallen men reach fallen men. And that's why the Bible calls it the foolishness of preaching. Adam got us into it, and we're going to crawl out of it. Jesus gets us out, and we're going to preach Jesus. We're going to speak the things of God. Notice this. God doesn't use angels. He doesn't use Gabriel to preach the gospel. He doesn't. You know, Cornelius says, call for Simon, whose surname is Peter. Why? Because you need a human vessel. Angels aren't going to do it. He could have sent an angel into the desert to meet the Ethiopian eunuch, but he doesn't. He picks up Philip and plants him in the wilderness and lets him stand by the side of the road, because you need a human to deliver a message of redemption. Don't you let the devil tell you you're not qualified. Because if you won't, the devil will. You ever notice that not only did God not use angels, God wouldn't let devils preach his word. You know, we talk about Matthew's account of Peter, where he says, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. Devils had that revelation to one degree or another. When he comes to the demoniac, he looks at the demoniac and the demoniac says, we know who you are. Have you come to torment us before the time? And he begins to talk about the power that Jesus has. And Jesus could have let him keep on going. Jesus could have let him, oh, Son of the Most High God. He could have let him add on the descriptive titles, but Jesus doesn't. He says, hold your peace. I don't want you praising me. I don't want devilish, satanic adoration. It's the kind of thing that when a woman, man, I feel the Holy Ghost right now. When a woman comes after the Apostle Paul, she says, these men are the servants of the Most High God. I thought, boy, she's paying them a compliment. You'd think they'd be happy. But Paul is grieved in his spirit. And he turns around and casts the devil out of her. Because that's not a clean spirit doing it. You're an improper vessel. You're a pipe that is corroded. And when the Holy Ghost shows up, I'm not going to send it through an empty or a dirty pipeway. I'm going to send it through a vessel that has been washed and sanctified and cleansed. And it may not be perfect, but it's enough to get the job done. I'm not going to run the kingdom through a dirty filter. The problem with a dirty filter is it has a way of messing up the product. You ever wonder why it says that they're doctrines of devils? That's because there's water flowing through there, but it's tainted water. It's a gospel message that loses something in the transfer as it comes through a satanic delivery system called denomination. And a delivery system that's tainted by the thoughts of men and by philosophies and by ideologies. Oh, hallelujah. It's coming through something. And it looks kind of like Christianity. And it tastes a little bit like Christianity. And yeah, there's Jesus. And yeah, there's Calvary. And yeah, there's the blood of the Lamb. But somehow the day of Pentecost is downplayed. And somehow receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost is left out. And somehow God went in one side as one. And He came out the other side as three. How'd that happen? It went through a filter that came from hell. And there's a message being pumped into this world as the devils try to send out a message of deceit. My, there has to be somebody that stands up and says, cleanse my lips, Jesus, and speak through me. I'll be a mediator. I'll be one who proclaims. I'll be one who preaches by your help. I can't say I'm the mediator. Jesus is the mediator. There's one mediator between God and men. But I'm going to preach His word. I'm going to preach His word. Amen. That spoken word of God. There's power when the word is spoken. There's power in preaching. You sit around preaching long enough. Now, I'm not talking about the lecturing and the sermonizing. Some people, they say, boy, Brother Urshan, you should tone it down. You're going to scare people because you're shouting. Don't tell me to slow down and be quiet when announcers at sporting events are screaming and car auctioneers are screaming and lotto winners are screaming. Man, I found the treasure hid in the field. And you want me to be quiet? No, sir. I'm going to proclaim this thing. He said, lift up your voice like a trumpet. Cry aloud and spare not. You come too late to tell me that I'm supposed to quiet it down. I'm not turning down the volume. I'm turning up the volume with all the competing voices in the world. I'm going to preach it with everything I have. My. I think if you can be offended by strong preaching, you're supposed to be offended by it. Amen. Nobody gets offended at the game show host. Come on down. You can do that, but you can't preach Acts 2:38. My. I think God chooses foolish instrumentalities so that the prideful have to humble themselves. Whew. Man, I think God chooses speaking in tongues. It's not an accident. It's not just an arbitrary decision. There's a spoken power behind that. My. And when you start speaking it, it starts creating something out here. It starts doing something out here. Try it sometime. You'll notice this in your own life. When you speak the wrong thing, you are opening up wrong things in your life. When you come home and you tell your wife, this is bad and that is bad and that's not good and this isn't good and I had a terrible day and this is wrong and my boss said this and I'm, by the time you get done with that, you're ready to go in the basement and dig ditches and bury yourself. You're just sinking lower and lower. You'll talk yourself into a backslidden condition. The devil will be so magnified that you'll believe it. You'll throw in the towel. You'll feel the hopelessness come in on you. You are creating an atmosphere of doubt and oppression. Don't you tell young people they're no good. That's wet cement. And while that cement is still impressionable, you have to speak life into them. Hallelujah. You are going to make it. God is able. Speak it. Speak it into their life. I love you. It's so good to see you. The power of life and death. It's not in the hands. It's not in the feet. It's in the tongue. Because there's something about that spoken word that has power. Speak it. Speak it to your children. Speak it to your husband. Even if you don't feel it, speak it anyway. Because it's not about your feelings. It's about the power of the spoken word. And if you feel like you're not going to make it, speak it anyway, because God says you can make it. If thine heart condemn thee, God is greater than your heart. So speak His word anyway. We're going to make it. It's going to be all right. God is able. God is great. And He's greatly to be praised. Amen. I don't know what you're going through, but God does. And let me tell you how preaching works. Instead of just giving data, instead of just giving information, God chose that. That's lecturing. That's teaching a secular dynamic. And there's all kinds of tools you can use. There's voice inflection. There's vocabulary. There's metaphor. There's simile. There's all kinds of dynamics that you can choose to impact people with verbal tools. Oh, but there's nothing like the Word of God. Hallelujah. Because I can use all those tools, but the raw material I'm working with, the Word of God, is alive all by itself. I told myself I wasn't going to get worked up, Brother Sandy, but now here I am getting all worked up. Amen. I'll tell you something else. I don't have to just get up here and just shout and call it preaching. I don't have to manufacture an anointing. Well, it's time to preach. I'll start shouting. Come on, everybody. Let's all praise God. God's great. Come on. Let's worship. And everybody's looking at me. All I'm doing is shouting. Preaching doesn't mean shouting. I don't shout and then it becomes preaching. I preach and I can't help shouting. There's anointing in this word. And when I grab a hold of this word, I'll use the metaphors. I'll use the voice inflection. Oh, but when I break into the Word of God, there's an anointing inside the Word itself. And it just kind of starts spilling out. It's like when you split an atom. It's just there and it's been there. But when you split it, there's a nuclear fission, fusion, atomic thermodynamic deal that out of the smallest little insignificant thing comes the kind of a power that can stop Imperial Japan in its footsteps and can back up Hitler. When I tell you, when you crack the Word of God, there's devils that gotta back up. There'll be a mushroom cloud in your family and in your life that says, devil, I'm about to drop a bomb on you, and it's called the Word of God.
running adultery out of here, and I'm running hatred out of here, and I'm running addiction out of here, and I got some enemies on my trail, but I've got power in the Word of God. They won't run from singing, but they'll run from preaching. They won't run from charisma, but they'll run from an anointed delivery of the Word of God. You don't know what I'm going through, Brother Urshan, but God does. You feel that little wave right there? You're tapping into something in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. There's power in the Word of God. The same stuff that was spoken that caused light to appear and darkness to be separated from that light and caused water to pull back and dry land to come up. Oh, hallelujah. The same stuff that caused stars and moons and sun to stay in place is the same word that will wash away your sins. When we baptize you in Jesus' name, and when we baptize you in Jesus' name, we're going to speak the name of Jesus. We're going to invoke the name of Jesus. Because it washes away sins. Praise God. Praise God. When you get the Holy Ghost, you're going to speak with other tongues. I'm closing. I don't want to preach much longer here. But let me talk a little bit about that. Don't be afraid to speak. You can't speak in tongues unless you speak. People seek for the Holy Ghost and they do this. Hasn't happened yet, Brother Urshan. When's this Holy Ghost business supposed to fall on me? But you have to open. You're not open. I'll tell you something interesting, too. I don't really have scripture for this. You know what? Yes, I do. I'm sorry. I was wrong. I do. I've never seen people get the Holy Ghost, and I'm sure they can, but I've never really seen it where they got the Holy Ghost closed in. I always notice, and this is just something I just kind of arbitrary, that when people open, I watch them pull their head back. There's something psychological connected to something spiritual, connected to something spiritual. And I do have scripture. The Bible says, lift up your head. Oh, ye gates. It doesn't mean gates like doors and gates. It means your eyes and your mouth and your ears, the gateways of your spirit. Lift up your head, oh, ye gates. Be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors. And if you will, the King of Glory shall come in. That's another way of saying, open up and the Holy Ghost will fill you. Like a king riding into the gates of the city triumphantly with palm branches waving. Like that, he comes riding into your gates and riding into your temple, riding into... When you open up your mouth, you're opening up the gates. Hallelujah. When you open up your senses, you're opening up the windows and the gates. I like it. The Bible teaches that Daniel prayed. He threw the window open and he called upon the name of Jehovah. I want to open some stuff up and speak the praises of Almighty God. This is why dead church doesn't work. Man, when you come in here, you got to get involved with the work of worship. This doesn't work. Just kind of sit there. Well, that wasn't a very powerful service. Boy, he didn't hardly preach nothing. He kind of hollered and did some cartwheels, but it didn't really move me.
Brother, that's not how it works. I don't preach. We preach. This isn't just the N.A. Urshan show. This isn't the Pastor Sandy show. This is never meant to be entertainment. That comes from a television society that Hollywood has taught to sit down with a box of popcorn and pop it in your mouth and wait for Johnny Carson to entertain you. Ah, that's not how the kingdom of God works. We're not entertained by him. We're the ones doing the entertaining. I create the atmosphere. I create the atmosphere. And I, just like he spoke the word, I speak the word. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thanks be to God. You feel it? You feel it rising up? The Bible says it'll be in you a well of water springing up, springing up, springing up in the everlasting life. Somebody speak the word today. My. There it is. There's an atmosphere. And it's not coming from me. It's coming from the people of God. Well, I hope you sing the right song because I need a good move of the Holy Ghost. That's not what does it. You got to speak it. Speak into the darkness. Speak into the chaos. Speak into the dysfunction. And God said, and God said, and God said. Yeah. Yeah. You feel it? You feel it? There's some people rising in the Holy Ghost right now. There's some faith rising in the Holy Ghost right now. Somebody is exercising that spoken word. Stop keeping it inside. Stop worrying and being depressed. Man, learn to pray. And when you pray, pray loud. Pray strong, effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man. The Bible says that his promises are yea and amen. There's a yea that comes from the pulpit. But then there's a confirmation that the yea has been received. And the sanctuary says, amen. Moses told the people, my God, have mercy. I can feel it all over me like electricity. Moses told the people, he said, I will heal your land. The earth will bring forth its increase. The heavens will pour down rain. I'll protect your children and I'll protect your livestock. And the Bible says the people said, amen. If you keep my word and if I will be your God and you will be my people, I will bless you. And the people said, amen. Creative word, saving word, redeeming word. Let's stop right there. Somebody lift your hands and somebody just exercise it right now. Somebody open your mouth. Jesus. Woo, Jesus. 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 He said, open your mouth and I will fill it. Yeah. Woo. Watch this. I'm going to open it up. We're going to come down to the front. Musicians can come. Amen. Start making your way down. I just feel like there's victory in this place right now. I want to talk to people that want the Holy Ghost but don't know how to get the Holy Ghost. Let me tell you what happens. People come down and they haven't got the revelation you're supposed to speak. Speak. Here's what the Bible says. It says that the word of faith is nigh thee,
It's, watch this. It doesn't say it's in your mind. It says it's in your mouth. So people will come down here and they'll get stuck in their mind. They'll come down here and they'll raise their hands and say, okay, I'm waiting on the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost. How's it going to happen? I don't know. Did you get the Holy Ghost? No. I don't know how. And they try to figure it out because they're trapped in their mind. But he never said he'd put it in your mind. The Holy Ghost is going to bypass your brain and go into your mouth. When the Holy Ghost comes on you, it's going to be because you're glorifying and praising the name of the living God. So learn how to open your mouth and praise Him, worship Him, magnify Him. Just get in the habit of speaking it out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, thank you, Jesus. My, I love you, Jesus. It's not a mental thing. It's not a logical thing. It's a Holy Ghost thing. Hey, I need you, Holy Ghost. I need you, Jesus. You're going to feel something come over you. You're going to feel hot oil go down your backbone. You're going to get the Holy Ghost goosebumps. Now watch. The Bible says you'll speak with other tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. And your mind will hit the brakes and say, blah, 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 blah. You're getting stuck in your mind. Don't you even pause. Don't you even slow down. When that Holy Ghost hits you, the word is nigh thee in thy mouth. And if you'll confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, thou shalt be saved. For with the mouth confession is made, and with the heart man believeth. Hey! That means you're going to speak with other tongues, brother, and speak it in faith. So God's going to put words in your mouth? I don't understand them. Don't worry about it. Speak it. Speak it. And it's the Holy Ghost. They spoke with other tongues. I wish I could take what we saw in Honduras, put it in a bottle and pour it out in South Haven, Mississippi. Because there's this little Hispanic girl. I would walk up to her and I would say, how are you? And she would say, oh, no hablo inglés, pastor. No entiendo. And I would say, you don't speak English? No hablo. No puedo. I cannot. And I wish I could just tell you what it felt like. Mother Gutierrez called me up and said, Pastor, you're not going to believe it. What happened? He said she came to church last night, had an evangelist, power of God hit her, and she got the Holy Ghost, and she spoke in tongues, and she was saying, thank you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Glory to God in the highest. You're holy. You're worthy. There's none beside you, because it bypasses your brain, and it comes out of your mouth. It's a word of faith, and you don't understand it, but God knows what it is. There's power in the word. Somebody lift your hands and somebody give Him praise right now. Somebody open up your mouth. Jesus! As they sing, right now, speak it out in the name of Jesus. Yay! Amen! Yay! Amen! Yay! Amen! Speak it! Speak it! Yeah!
just speak it. And God said, and God said, and God said, and God said, Gloria a Dios.
say.